winning against them is probably our most important match out of the Super League.
It's definitely the biggest game, because if we beat Complexity, that pretty much guarantees us a playoff spot, and that's definitely the most important thing. It'd be great to beat Dig and Complexity and just get enough wins that we're like maybe fifth in the playoffs, so we don't have such a hard schedule, and we believe that if we get into playoffs, we can go to Worlds.
Welcome back to the North American LCS, everybody. I'm David Freak Turley, and teleporting to the desk with me, using Flash as his F key, by the way, is Joshua Jad Leisman. Kicking off our day with Team Curse versus Complexity, an all split. This has been a hotly contested matchup. And their last meeting broke the record for longest game in the LCS, clocking in at over 80 minutes.
Yeah, and Freak, as we just heard, both teams know how incredibly important this game is as they look towards the postseason. I mean, Curse can basically guarantee their playoff spot with a win here. Not mathematically, but it would be pretty damn, we'll talk about it later. However, Complexity is coming off another big upset win over Dignitas, and they're riding a little momentum of their own. And if you look at the head-to-head here, Complexity are the favorites, actually. They've won two of the three games against Curse this split, so they're going to be fighting hard to put themselves one game behind Curse and within reach of the playoffs, which before the whole split would have been absurdity.
Right, you talked about this, the fact that the playoff race is pretty close. So Complexity are two games back right now, and if they win, they own the tiebreaker, meaning they just need plus one, and they're sixth. Mm-hmm. Like, if they win that match. For Curse, if Curse wins right here, they're 2-2 in the series, and they're up three games, meaning even if they go 0-3 since then, and Complexity 3-0 their last three games, there's still a tiebreaker.
Exactly. That's why I actually ran into Voyboy, luckily, in the hallways. He said, well, time to play our most important game in the split, which is true.
I ran into Quas, and I was like, so what's your goals here? And he was like, just make playoffs. It's like, not third, not, but just stick in the top six. So see if they can do it. To get an insider's perspective on this match, let's throw it down to Dash, who's on the red side.
Thanks, guys. I'm here, Rift side, with Koobs, the coach and analyst for Complexity. Now, my first question is, 1 week left in the split. How has this journey been for the team?
Man, it's been really fun. I know it's been our first split, and there's been a lot of improvement here. Like, coming from the first week to now, I think we've become a team that teams viewed as a free win to a team that people need to respect, otherwise we'll take games off them. And moving forward, we just want to keep improving and do the best we can and continue to blue turtle shell.
I like it. I like the confidence. Now, you as a coach and an analyst, though, what's it like being in the LCS? Because we don't get to see that side of it very often.
It's definitely new to esports and like bringing in the industry like the way the Koreans do. For me personally, like I was never a player. I was never a challenger, like top 10 player. So it's like I constantly have had to make sure that I prove myself to not only my team, but the results kind of speak for it. So it's been really fun to coach against guys like Monte Cristo, Loco, Scara, all these guys who I've watched for all these years to get to like coach against them. It's been phenomenal, and I've learned a lot, and I'm really grateful for it.
Having been someone who isn't considered a, or wasn't a top player, how do you kind of compensate for that when you're prepping for with the team and how you're coaching?
Well, okay, my style's like really unorthodox, and I don't want to go too much into it, but as a coach, you have to have a definitive style. You have to approach the game a certain way, and you have to understand your players. The analogy I use is every player either needs a bowl of whipped cream or a bowl of poop, and if you can figure out which players need the whipped cream and which ones need that, the other one, then you'll be okay.
All right, okay. there it is, there it is. All right, my next question would be that in the beginning of this split, we saw a lot of 4-0s, we saw lane swaps, double jungle, a lot of innovation, but we're watching things go back to standard lanes. So as a coach and analyst, do you see that shifting again anytime in the near future? Do you guys have plans to make or force a shift?
Well, see, our plans are hidden, and we're not going to discuss those, but as far as the meta goes, I think it's still fine to lane swap like bad matchups if it fits your composition and you understand how to play the lane swap. And that's always been one of our strengths as a team, is adapting and actually innovating the meta. I know like the buddy system, for example, was something like we kind of did first in NA. But I think with the lane swaps, it's very situational on the team. And if you want to do it, you can. And as we move forward, who knows?
All right, finally, are we going to see Complexity in the playoffs?
See, this one is funny because for the last week, I've been reading the Reddit and stuff, and no one's even mentioned that. And it's kind of like, Complexity is going to get relegated. And I'm like, you know, that's motivation for us. And like, I think we have the best fans like in the world. And for us, that's our motivation. And I think if we have a good Super Week, it's possible. And it starts right now, today against Curse and C9. And if we do well, who knows?
That's a fantastic attitude. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me, and best of luck in your matches this Super Week. We're going to send it right back up to Freak and Jat to get us into the game.
Thank you very much, Dash and Koobs. And Jat, which would you prefer? Which bowl?
Which bowl? I think that's a pretty easy answer.
Yeah. Poop is great. Let's get ourselves into... Let's get right into starting lineups here on the blue side. Team Curse, Kwas, I Will Dominate, Void Boy, Cop, and Xspecial. All hitting the rip on the blue side.
On the red side right here, trying to make a run at the playoffs, it's Complexity. Westrush in the top lane, Kez in the jungle, Prawly in mid lane, and then Robert X Lee and Bubba Dub in the bot.
All right, guys, so Complexity's run of the playoffs starts right now. Curse having a very interesting split where they keep nearly achieving greatness, and it feels like the pressure seems to get them pretty often. Either from game starting slow, someone having to hop out of their chair and then kind of hop back in, or just simply the fact that they keep saying that these guys win like 90% of their scrims and can't translate it. They're now in their highest pressure game of the split.
They
and
know
it's time
it too.
To turn it on.
They know that it is the highest pressure, and from here on out, it's not like it gets less pressuring. If they make the playoffs, well, they want to make it to Worlds.
It's true.
An Aurelia ban, actually.
Well, that says Nidalee to me somewhat.
Yeah, me
I know
too.
A lot of the NA pros say Nidalee is beaten up by Aurelia. Westrace did.
I kind of feel like Nidalee is held in check.
Held in
by
check.
Aurelia.
Okay.
Because we've seen that matchup go both ways, but at least Aurelia can jump on top of Nidalee and punish her a little bit.
Well, we saw Complexity beat up Dignitas with the Aurelia just basically last week, so.
Yeah.
Gotta figure that's their chance right here to stymie that. The Evelynn goes away from Kez, smart choice. That's pretty much his favorite jungler. And otherwise, not very surprising bans. Two bans aimed at Void Boy, Kassadin and Tristana. Didn't expect to say that ever in commentating history, but those are Void Boy bans.
It's unfortunate too, because Prawly has had some success this split on Kassadin as well as Robert X Lee on Trist.
That's true, actually. Complexity are banning two of three champions they would really like to play themselves.
Absolutely.
But they don't want to risk it getting picked out here. They're not risking the Kassadin counter pick either. So Curse get first pick. Is it going to be Nidalee since they removed one of the counters, quote unquote, to it? Is it Elise to deny more from Kez? I feel like he'll go back and forth to the two E junglers every single time.
Yeah. Keep in mind, this is the 4.12 patch.
Mm-hmm.
I actually feel like it'll be... Of NA and EU, this is the last time we're going to be playing on the 4.12 patch. Is this Super Week?
Yeah.
Because EU playoffs will be on 4.13, which is what everyone is on the live service with. And it makes sense that Curse picks Lulu here. Actually, in one of their defeats last week, they let Lulu slide because they wanted to try Shen. Yet before that, Kwas had been dominating four games in a row on Lulu.
And he's going to go back to it right here. So Curse is... Kwas, Lulu going to hold the top lane here. Westrife's going to make his own choices now. Of course, Gragas in his full glorious drinking power is still available if you want to play a couple of mages up there. Kez does get the Elise if he wants it. Lee Sin really not contested between the two very much, so.
Yeah, that's true.
It'd be surprising if it showed up here in Champ Select.
Dominate, I believe, still hasn't played Lee Sin in the LCS this split.
Not to my knowledge.
Starts today. Now we'll see.
I mean, hey, Saint learned it and became an incredible Lee Sin player as of late, actually, in the Challenger Series.
They actually might be trying to push him onto it right here. They're going to say... Well, we're going to talk about the Maokai.
Yeah, let's go ahead and
do that. Before we have the fun with the jungle.
So, Maokai.
Top lane Maokai saw a ton of play in Europe during Super Week.
Yeah.
Drew bans in multiple situations, yet no one was really like, ah, they're just silly Europe, they're just playing Maokai.
Mm-mm.
And then we got to see... Spoiler alert, the OGN semifinals last week between, last night, between Samsung Blue and White. And in the first game, Acorn played in the top lane from Samsung Blue and went something like 10-1-20 or something. And it was banned throughout the rest of it. Definitely a new emerging power in the top lane. Europe always finds it.
Mm-hmm.
And then people don't take it seriously until Korea plays it for some reason.
After Worlds, everyone started banning Aatrox. Like, you know what? Actually, this champion's incredible. See what else Europe can bring out here. The Zilean, I guess... I think Zilean came first in Europe as well. Because people were playing it off and on in support before Faker played it mid, and then everyone kind of hopped on that train.
Yeah. Also, I don't know about that, because we saw support Zilean at All-Stars.
That's true.
As well.
You're right.
From SKT.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, Orianna coming through. Kog'Maw there as well, so everyone's splitting up their lanes for a bit. No supports, conventional supports grab just yet, though, but Kop will be well set up to deal plenty of damage with a bunch of supports already on his team.
That should be pretty fun.
Yeah.
Kop has had some successful games on Kog'Maw for sure. But he has always been that type of AD carry to sit near the back and try and pick up kills. And when you're running an Orianna Lulu comp like this, he's got to be able to flip that switch and go full-on aggressive, which has always been a difficult thing for comp. I like the picks, though.
You know, it's interesting, actually, is Cop played this Kog'Maw last time these guys met in the 80-minute game. He went 9-3-6, and it was still too much for him because their base eventually went down. But Complexity going to run their own hyper carry in the bot lane. Jinx coming through. Braum to support, so a fairly scary lane to fight against.
Yeah, and Braum picked again, though, with Morgana still on the table.
True.
X-Special's had some pretty darn good Morgana games.
Yes, he has.
So I'd expect that pick right here. And then the big question we'll need to answer is what I Will Dominate plays in the jungle. Does he break out a Lee Sin, or does he just go back to maybe something like a Pantheon? I mean, a lot of stuff is taken away here when we consider the full breadth of jungle pool.
So I would actually kind of like Vi right here, because she's one of the few champions. No.
They're protecting the carry anyway.
Yeah, oh my god, yeah. Four supports plus Cop. So the thought about Cop has been, is this kind of his breakout split? He'd always been criticized as a very passive player. We've seen him play a lot more aggressively so far this year. And now he's pretty much got to be the guy dealing damage if this team wants to win. Meanwhile, Soon is going to face up against Orianna in the mid lane.
Damn. That's exciting. That's also Dominate's first game on Nunu. Split. He had previously played four straight Evelynn games, and then they themselves banned Eve. Oh, never mind. He has one game on Nunu. I tell a lie. So it was a defeat against EG, actually.
It was almost the exact same comp. That game was Lulu, top lane, Nunu, jungle, yep. Ori mid, Kage, yep. Carry, Nami support instead.
They've tried this before,
yeah.
Right? And Cop typically doesn't succeed in protect the carry compositions. In general, it's not that successful of a strategy just in League of Legends as a whole,
yeah.
Because you need to have diversified threats. So this game will actually be not just about Kog'Maw, because Kog'Maw will be threatening with this mm-hmm. many people defending him, no matter what. It's about the second and potentially third threats. How big can Voyboy and Quas get, and how much damage can they deal to each their own?
Oh, we'll see how the matchups go, because probably thought he'd kind of pick that with Syndra. We'll see if that works out in the matchup. Before the game gets underway, let's check out your guys' predictions. And according to LOLesports.com, two-thirds of you say that Curse is going to grab the win.
Yeah, keep those votes coming, though, because these games occasionally go a little bit long. Tweet hashtag CRS win or hashtag COL win to @LOLesports, and we will continue to update the fan vote. You were mentioning beforehand.
Yeah. Did you know?
I did, but you can go for it because you figured out the stat.
The average game time, this split between Complexity and Curse, is over an hour.
Correct. All right.
Super Week is going to be long, guys.
Yeah.
It's going to be fun.
That's one way to start the day.
It's going to be big, though. It's a potential tiebreaker match here. Again, 2-1 so far on the split. Complexity leads that. So if you want to go for the two-thirds thing, that should be Complexity up above.
True.
But this is a win I feel like Complexity basically must get if they want to make the playoffs.
It feels like a must-win for both teams. I mean, even if Curse lost this one, it immediately just dials the pressure up to 11 for the rest of the split.
Yeah.
Let's
see what we got here, guys. Off to the Rift they go. Curse going to make their way out of the blue base. Pretty normal starts all around. An extra ward here for I Will Dominate. Wants to set his team up for success with the vision control. I guess to me, you talk about the fact that Curse needs an extra damage threat. That is very likely to be Voyboy primarily.
Yeah. Voyboy's Orianna has been improving every time he plays the champion. Been continually impressed with his growth as a mid laner. Actually, though, X-Special. He doesn't even have Black Shield.
It's five
they get
gold
a few more hits,
to get the stuns.
They would have to flash to force a flash. And they decide not to.
Okay. Well, advantage Curse. X-Special's got $5. Despite the scariness.
Five gold coins. Plus, there's knowledge of where Complexity warded, whereas Complexity doesn't have knowledge of where Curse warded.
That's true. So, a couple saplings down. Wester's going to recall back for mana. And this is the first Maokai, I think, total we're seeing NALCS. And one thing I've noticed is very strong about the champion is how much sustain he has. Because every, what, 7 to 8 spells. There we go. Jeez. Complexity looking a lot better on the
those
vote now.
Complexity fans. Koobs did call, and they have the best fans in the world. They're supporting on Twitter as well.
Mm-hmm.
Curse has some pretty nice fans as well. These are two teams that have a lot of solid personality on the team.
Oh, yeah.
They're just not quite being able to turn the corner into a great team. I was talking about Voidboy's Orianna a little bit as well. Some of his previous games, against CLG in week 7, 7-0-5. Against Complexity in that 80-minute game, he went 3-2-12. Even in their loss to EG, he was 2-3-7. Like, it's a champion that Void Boy has a lot of success on. A conventional mid laner that he typically hasn't excelled on. This is kind of the exception to the rule where he's pretty good at Ori.
This was like the first champion I felt like he really tried Dylan. I remember watching his stream when he very first converted to mid lane. He's spending a bunch of Orianna games. Like, that was the first one I felt like he tried to learn. So far, it's going out pretty well for him. This is his first split as a mid laner, right? Or is it, two now?
It's his first year as a mid laner.
First season.
Yeah, if that makes sense. He's a player who's been around since really the dawn of season 2. And when you compare him to other mid laners, he's actually substantially less experienced in the role. You look at the guys from every other LCS team, and they've been playing mid lane really since the game's inception and never changed roles. So it's been an uphill battle for Void Boy in almost all of his matches this split, but he's getting there.
Ah, missed two minions right there.
I mean, if he'd been playing mid lane for 2 more years, he wouldn't have missed that.
Yeah, easy. Just predicted the ball so much better there. The minions changed in different lanes. You know, they do more damage in the mid lane. Just gotta get used to them. Void Boy. Are we just groaning for every missed CS now? Yes, we are.
As long as we're watching. He's gonna get this one.
This is the more frequent version of wards. Yeah!
Hey-o.
40 goals, that's one that matters. Kez!
Has he been over-focusing on CS? Sometimes when you miss a few, you get vulnerable to these ganks.
Oh, what a flash, though. Gets away from the stun. Still loses the summoner spell.
And still took a bunch of damage because Kez had great gank positioning right there. A Void Boy can place his trinket ward to avoid future ganks, and lane will be shoving towards him. So he should be safe for a little bit, but they've lost a lot of mid lane pressure.
Oh, jeez. But Kez already has a sweeper. Dominates right around the wing. Puts a new one down. Yeah. Zay, I know about this one.
That's the problem with those early game sweepers. They're on such a long cooldown that Kez can't get one back.
It's 10 gold and extra CS.
90-second cooldown on that rank 1 sweeper.
Yeah. Well, see what they can do. Probably still tossing some Dark Spheres down. Void taking a bit of damage. Has to chug his second potion now, so Void is out of sustain. And he is about 10 CS down the lane so far. So this Syndra pick right now is working out, and Kez's quick visit doing stuff as well. Of course, Nunu not the best early ganker, so I don't know if we're going to see much from Dominate.
Yeah, it's very true. Nunu would want to counter gank or just sit in a lane and pressure, but for now, he's really just working on some ward control. He has yet to really neutralize Kez. That's usually the point of a Nunu, is to just stop the other jungler from having an impact for a while. Hasn't worked yet for Dominate because Kez did have a pretty big sway in that mid lane.
And the trinket just put down is timed out. Kez looked for the mid lane, couldn't find it, and Void Boy is just hiding back as far as he can.
Boy, that's a defensive opening from Westrise. Not only did he start with a crystalline flask, he goes back to base and buys a Doran shield.
Yeah.
Maokai will most likely be going for a Rod of Ages as his first item. That's what we've seen from the top lane Maokais. But it's going to be a while until he gets to that point. We'll have to see if Quas can take advantage of that. Because once Maokai does get to that Rod of Ages, he becomes a beast.
Yeah, Visage is a really big spike for him as well, but Dominate going to look to create pressure.
This is absurdly risky.
Right,
I mean, they have the pink
here.
Ward, but
they're walking up to him. This has got to go down really fast. Kez right around the wings, but here's Bubba Dub. Bubba Dub's there a little bit.
They
late
get
damage coming through.
Down.
Consume Smite. Is it going to come in time? Kez wants it, and he gets the steal with the Smite. Dominate smited early, and now the damage comes across. Robert is forced to run away. He will go down for first blood. And Curse gets some vengeance for the dragon going down.
Something happened with Westrise's teleport right there because it's on cooldown and he did not teleport down.
He TP'd top.
He TP'd top just then and started walking down.
A while ago.
Oh, right.
Yeah, he had TP'd back. Quas had his. He was walking the lane.
Freak with the knowledge. That play, though, in specific, was a huge steal by Kez because they still suffered a casualty thanks to the TP of Quas. And then Westrise actually wasted a bunch of time afterwards walking down to no avail. He could have been shoving top lane in all the meanwhile, but because of the Dragon Steel, Complexity has a small early game lead.
And 400 gold for them, and it's going to be cash all across the board. Westrise, for what it's worth, does now hold a CS lead in that top lane. And in fact, now his TP comes up about a minute sooner, probably closer to 2 minutes sooner. He TP'd to a turret instead of a minion.
Very true. The cooldown difference, it'll be 140 seconds for Westrise, but about 240 seconds left on Quas's teleport.
All right.
So a good minute and a half window there where Westrise could teleport and make a play if he so chooses.
Oh, minions going down very successfully for Void Boy. Full wave. There you go, guys.
I'm still a little perplexed by Curse's choice to dragon there. I could see it being safer if Quas would have teleported down for the take itself. because that would have made it more suicidal for Kez to go in for a steal in the first place because Quas could have zoned him out. But instead, they made it a steal battle, which Kez was able to win. I think that was a poor timing of teleport there for Curse.
Yeah. It was like a calculated risk where it's like, I think they might not check. Maybe they had that pink ward down. There's no wards here.
True. As soon as Kez was spotted in the ward, I think they should have taken the teleport.
Yeah, no, you're right. That would have been a bit safer for them. Bubba Dub says, hey, that's a ward. Kills that. 30 gold for himself. Didn't miss the CS there. It's pretty hard to, I suppose.
Just that sweet ward money.
Ooh. Special blocks out the slow. Puddle gets him some money back, and Robert X Lee is going to have to chug a health potion. Yeah, pickaxe with, to Phage.
Exactly, and with the early pickaxe, you kind of see he didn't want to come to back to lane empty-handed. He was the lone fatality from that dragon contest, and I think in a perfect world, he would have laned until BF Sword. This will eventually slow down his power. Now he has to wait for his next BF Sword, which will give Kopp a window of power if he can go back and get another component of his Trinity Force before Robert gets BF.
Yeah.
I don't know if that'll happen before level 6, though.
Well, it's going to be about a 300 gold difference between the two items. Robert did cash in on boots as well, so he kind of reset his gold back to zero.
True.
Occasionally, you'll see people just like really delay boots and say, no, I really want this combined as soon as possible. I've seen AD carries not have boots, like boots one, three items in on like Ezreal. Every once in a while. They just want the damage output. Boy, boy. More wards going down. Sweeper is coming out. Curse already has three, as does Complexity here. And right now we've seen Curse, red buff, level 6 looking in the southern jungle with Bubba Dub.
Dominate, do you dare counter jungle the Nunu?
There's a spider. Cocoon lands. Spiderling's there as well. The slow comes out. He's going to have to flash the wall and does so because does not want to chase an enemy territory. And is not going to be able to smite the big golem either. But hey, it's a flash down and control over the bottom jungle. Quas and Westrise in a bit of a trade right there. Shield comes out. Good harass down.
Now Westrise is just taking as much damage as he can. I think he's going to TP back to lane again for defensive purposes. Talking about that counter jungling move by Kez, though, this is a complete role reversal from what is supposed to happen in a Nunu versus Elise matchup, or what at least we've seen every time this matchup has went down. It's the Nunu pushing Elise off buffs normally, but Kez has been the one to get the first sight stone, establish vision control, and harass the Nunu off of buffs. So fantastic job by Kez and crew to make that happen.
Even secured neutral objectives.
Yep.
That's like Nunu's like number one hallmark. So
he stole it.
Yeah. So Kez playing great. You know, the ban on Evelynn came through, but Curse did not place a high priority on stealing the Elise away. Kez takes that first round, and by doing so, gives Curse Orianna Kog'Maw.
That's a lot of damage.
A lot of damage on a Robert. The flash that comes in. Nice knockup there from Bubba. I've actually just narrowly missed the special, it looks like. Big damage off onto the Morgana, though. One hit from dead. Robert still in the fight.
Oh, man.
One hit from Get Excited. No, that's not going to be enough damage. The Zap missed as well, but here comes Crawley. There's the kill up top. Flashes in for Robert, but he's going to get stunned. And a double kill for Crawley. Get Excited trying to run away. Looks like Jinx passive hard counters Kog'Maw's.
Oh man, what a fight there for Complexity. The Braum Jinx out-dueling the Kog'Maw Morg right there, using all summoner spells in the exchange. But basically, it was just because Prawley roamed down. He did have Void Boy pushed in ever so slightly and was able to roam down because this fight was pretty much going to be zero kill by the very end of it because they traded everything quite well, obviously. The level 6 damage from Kopp's ultimate was quite a lot onto Robert. And right here, X Special, he was going to get away if Prawley didn't make it through. But then he gets the flash Q, and they finish him off. Kopp tries to flash in. A smart move to get in for the desperation, but miscalculated the fact that Get Excited is faster than the Kog'Maw passive. Today I learned.
Yep. Did you know, actually, Get Excited slows down whilas Kog'Maw speeds up? Like, you get
really?
The burst at the beginning, and then it tapers off. Kog'Maw actually accelerates through the passive, so couldn't quite catch in time.
You could kind of tell Kopp was saying, even if I don't get this kill, I'll kill him with my passive because he's out of summoner spells.
Couldn't quite do it. It's pretty unfortunate for Kopp, but maybe they can claw their way back into this one. Only down 1,000 gold right here, and you know, you said, hey, maybe these guys can match up with a second item, but the two assists let Robert X Lee get his BS sword the same time as the Zeal, but he has no potion, so Robert, zero sustain. He was waiting on ambient gold when he bought the BF sword.
True. I wonder. Let me check his runes as well. Yeah, he has 3% lifesteal, so...
Adorn's Blade?
Yep.
That's it.
That's it.
I was about to be like, two quints. Wait, no.
Yeah.
It's past 4.10. Well, pink horde control here for complexity. Two of them already on top of the dragon area.
Exactly.
It dominates.
No summoner spells down for either AD carry. Both very immobile, so this next fight could be a little bit hazardous for AD carries if they go in at the wrong time.
Yeah.
Both top laners have their teleports up as well. If they decide to match or stay up, they both have ways of interrupting each other's teleports. It's really all about vision control here and how imposing complexity can act. They're pretty damn imposing right now. But the dragon will pack a punch if they try and do it.
Absolutely. A
bit of a standoff.
Yeah. And honestly, the only lane that's really making headway is the top lane, actually. Westrace was forced back to base, has the Rod of Ages, but Kwass is nearly going to take this turret down in a completely untarnished one-on-one. Kwass's first pick, Lulu, takes the turret down, equals CS to Westrace, but has gold for his team now.
True. I think it's a good thing he took it down there because Westrace just finished his Rod of Ages, which is a huge item for Maokai. And Kez feels like he has enough vision control. We could see a repeat of the last fight, but roles reversed. He's got to back away before taking too much damage. He's also going to be out of Spiderlings when this fight starts.
Mm-hmm.
If Curse could find a correct initiation, it might be their way back into the lead.
Special keeps taking zaps to the back of the head, though. Damage comes through. Slow doesn't because of Black Shield. And he's seeing this bottom lane turret down about half HP. I think right now, Complexity's AD carry does a little bit more damage than
Team Fight. Interesting that I Will Dominate is playing around that red buff when the dragon is so clearly the contestable objective.
Oh yeah, wow. They might just be giving this one up and trying to play for something else. Maybe they can pressure something, but this dragon goes over to Kaz very cleanly. Complexity claimed that one. Cursed wanted to play somewhere else on the map and said, you know what, they got us here. Should be a pretty clean smite on this. There's the red buff steal.
Found the Nunu. Complexity made an educated guess there that Nunu wasn't going to be in range. Just because the rest of Curse was backing off so much and they just brute forced the dragon down.
So Westrace is getting back to his turn.
Very curious call, honestly. I think it was dangerous for them to walk up towards that pit just with how strong Prawly was with his Athene's Unholy Grail. But still, giving up that mid-game dragon, making it two dragons to zero, is a bit of a gold deficit they're putting themselves in now.
That's true. I wonder if they could have even have sent three guys top, like run Boy Boy there as well, go for the tier
two. Go for the second tier, yeah.
Yeah, take something even bigger than a red buff off of the assumed dragon take. But red buff steals all Curse gets, and it's going to be a 1,700 gold game. Complexity, you know, I was actually talking to Koobs in their green room earlier today, and he was saying he actually wished they could play the full starting lineup of CLG this week. Because he said, our early games are so good, we wanted vengeance and prove that we could beat one of these top teams. He said, you know, they're feeling very confident coming into this week.
Right. Well, it was Curse again who had first blood, but because of the Dragon Steel, Curse has never had that early game lead, which puts him in a very precarious situation since Curse still hasn't displayed great playmaking when behind in games.
It's true. We'll see if they can get some better objective trades than a red for a dragon, or if they're going to let this peter out. We're going to see what kind of damage threats they even have in this game. As Cop tries to hold onto this lane, Complexity are going to get this turret. Get excited for Robert. Decides not to go in. He's about to run into three people, but Kez is trying to ward up this Nunu. We've really yet to see much of anything from Dominate so far.
Things are going to get so interesting this Super Week if Complexity wins this game, Freak.
Yeah.
It's going to be a race down there for that final playoff spot. Curse, as you mentioned before the game, with the win here, would basically have to lose the remaining three games with Complexity going 3-0 in order to not take sixth.
Yep.
Yet, if Curse loses this one to Complexity, it is a one-game difference.
Yep.
And Complexity would hold the tiebreaker.
See if they can find that. There we go. Kwass looking for vengeance onto Prawly. Some damage comes through. Nice slow. The Flash Force Shockwave only catches the support, and Prawly doesn't care too much about that. Special going to be going down rapidly. I Will Dominate takes a rocket to the face, and here comes Westrice. Puts the ulti down, and they're going to keep chasing onto this one. Looks like Curse going to lose one, have the Force away.
I believe the Braum Shield stopped Voy Boy's command attack, which then made the Shockwave miss, which is why Prawly got out with his life there. Didn't even have to burn his Cinder Ult, and now Complexity is 5 strong in the mid lane.
And this mid lane turret's going to take a whole bunch of pain right there. It's not enough for Curse to defend. Two shots to go. Robinson takes that one out. Low health and mana bars, though. Complexity will back off with a kill and a turret. as their spoils of war.
And this is turning into a pretty big edge. Curse needs to make something happen now. They're going for it, but Braum is a tough man to get through.
The mustache soon as he's there, man. Braum plus Bubba Dub. Match made in heaven for these guys. Going to keep
really
their,
is.
Yeah.
Surprise is not a permaban.
Exactly. Or a first pick all the time here. You get that one late in champs, like, but the counterattack now Curse saying, you know what, you guys are low on resources. We can push mid back. This is tough for Complexity. If they stay too long, yeah, they could lose a fight.
Teleport down for Westrise as well. I almost feel like Complexity wants to give this one up to be safe, but instead Curse decides to back away.
Look, Special is all summoned.
They did run out of minions, which was pretty key.
Yeah. Looks like that was just enough time. Mid laner and jungler went back.
Yeah, so this is the game. Quas goes for the knockout first, and let's watch. Yep, see?
Yep.
The Orianna ball will not go through a Braum shield. Boy Boy assumed it would and was trying for the quick shockwave. That's why probably stayed alive. At that point, Xspecial was overcommitted. He got finished in. The teleport from Westrise is actually ineffective because they were running away anyways and they had nothing to follow with the Maokai. But when all was said and done, it was the play of Bubba Dub that created that action. Well, created the kill.
Yeah. It was wonderful and they got a turret for it as well, even though Curse was the one ganking. Great reactive play by Complexity. They all got there in time. Even Jinx managed to show up and press R, so that was pretty cool. But Curse are back. They really want this turret. Bubba Dub taking a bit of damage. Tormented Soil there as well. Turret now down to 1/3 HP. Cop not really being threatened here. Two shots from dead. Turret goes down. Curse find that. Complexity were pushing top and bottom with Robert and Westrise during that time.
Westrise just trying to farm up as much as possible. When he can get his Spirit Visage, it will be a really big moment for that Maokai. Knowing that it's already Lulu Ori double AP, the fact that Kog'Maw is a heavy amount of magic damage on AD carry as well.
Yeah.
It's almost tankier than a Mundo.
Yeah.
In the right situation. If he keeps his damage reduction on and if he's able to proc his passive for the percent health heal on auto attacks.
Think about how many low cooldown spells there are on Curse. Double Athenes, right? Orianna Q is what, like a base 3 second cooldown in the first place?
Every auto attack basically will be a heal for Westrise if we get into those big chaotic team fights.
That is a scary tree. I'm just saying.
It will be. If he could ever get to a Spirit Visage and then builds. Obviously, cooldown reduction is needed, but a Warmog's on top of that, he would just be unkillable.
Oh my gosh, that would be really rough. Oh, the blue buff. Yep, so sorry, for some reason I thought Morgana was on the other team, and Voiba like narrowly dodged the Dark Binding because of the Golem. I was like, what a great respawn, but nope. Voiba grabs the blue pretty securely, no counter juggling at all from Complexity so far.
Yeah, but Dragon in 15 seconds, and look at the vision right now.
Again.
Curse doesn't have vision. Complexity does. That's good for Complexity. They can definitely get some picks out of the Fog of War here, which is why Curse is trying to push the top lane. Knowing they have the teleport advantage, Complexity may be willing to give up a turret for this dragon here.
You know what's funny is Curse could rush at Baron at any time. They have ward control and a Nunu Kog'Maw, and they would force Complexity off this. It's not going to happen. Dragon, third time in a row, goes to Kez right here. They're up three. They're up two kills. They're up three dragons. They're up 4,000 gold.
But after this, probably down a turret. Maybe a couple, because Curse is trying to roam and find a fight here. What you doing, Westrise? It's go time!
He's trying to fight up against Quast here. Both teams making their way gingerly over to this lane. Westrise wins that trade pretty hard, but there's the Vine and a Kez shot that comes in. That's a dead Elise. And now Bubba Dub might have to just pop the ulti and run away, but he's still taking damage. Second kill picked up for Cop, and now Robert's got to be real careful. Flash the wall, but Cop's going to chase him down. He wants a triple. He gets it!
Hey, you're talking about Baron as well after that catch. They're going to be able to do that, Baron.
And the shutdown goes over for Voiboy off the trade on only Xspecial. Smites up for Dominate. This could be it.
Wow, that completely changes the complexion of this game. Curse finding a fight in the jungle when Complexity was rotating through late. Complexity had so many wards in the dragon area, they did not ward their own jungle as they were moving through, and Curse completely capitalized here. They're going for this Baron. Westrise might try and stop him.
He is a very tanky tree, and
he's
doing plenty of damage.
Go for Boy Boy.
There's a sapling.
Anyone.
Flashes in for Cop, actually.
Oh,
he wants this
for steal.
The ulti comes in. There's Kez. He picks up the jungler, and now Cop's getting chased down, and Complexity turned back around. One quarter health. Cop helps Baron go down faster with some spells. He wants to push Westrise off. Westrise could heal on an auto attack. Kez gets the shield. They're barely killing this thing in time. He's got to land the smite,
he's
though. That's the Baron. Nashor picked up a Complexity. Find the Baron, but here comes Quas. Half HP, blown up by Robin X Lee. Are there more kills to be picked up? Kappa
was one hit from dead. They chase onto Special first, though. They're going to trade that one down, and like three or four kills come in for Curse.
Holy crap, Freak. That was a ridiculous series of events. I would say MVP there was the home guard enchantment on Kez's boots, because he got there so fast. Curse thought they were just going to have to deal with the Maokai, and then when Elise showed up, all hell broke loose. Curse was already low from the fight and the Baron, and Complexity came in one after the other as their respawn timers and home guard boots got them there.
Yeah.
And they're back in control.
And I gotta say, beautiful patience by West Rice as well.
He going spotted in at the right time, yeah.
Right. It's like, okay, at about 3,000-4,000 health, then I'll go in. Watch this. He waits around,
I mean,
has the
just
ward.
Look at this. He's really waiting for Elise. And he says, all right, they're here. I'm going on Cop because he's the biggest threat to Baron right now, knowing Kez can deal with Dominate. He deals with Dominate real quickly, and they push Curse off. And at this point, what you
Baron,
really do
Baron,
is Curse.
Baron.
They don't want to go off the Baron, but come on, you guys are solo. They're waiting, actually, on the respawn of Quas because he's saying, guys, I can teleport in. But something miraculous happens when he teleports in. He just takes a huge amount of damage. There's...
Zap Flame Chompers. What can you do about that?
He just
Robert
jumped
was
into
right
a trap
time.
Right there. Robert X. Lee again coming from the base. And they just completely clean up.
Jeez.
All right, then.
Yeah.
So now we're here.
And Complexity are up 5,500 gold.
Westeros actually goes not for a Spirit Visage, but for a Locket of the Iron Solari.
Okay.
It's understandable because it gives the team more tankiness. They're just a little bit less individual stats. Still gives them the cooldown reduction and the MR, just not the enhanced healing.
Yeah, and what an... I mean, knowing Westeros, what an interesting choice in build. This is the old Akali main. This guy wants to one-on-one everybody all the time. And he came in week one, actually, with the worst stats of the top laners. Hundreds of, like, not
Ooh,
literally,
this is
a lot of deaths. And he's grown so much as a player, though. Right? Full utility focus, setting up the team, perfect patience there to go for the Baron fight at the right time. To me, most improved player of the split.
Definitely shows up. He even drew an Aurelia ban.
Yep. I mean, he knocked down Zion Spartan last week. Heavily sort of regarded as one of the best top laners.
That's a lot of wards.
That is a lot of vision, but it's like
wants to
for
see
both
people.
Teams, basically.
Yeah.
They're like alternating.
A lot of this can revolve around one catch. It's a little bit harder to catch Curse because they can put so many shields down on a single target.
Oh.
And you don't generally kill a Maokai at this point in the game, so it's still a good bit of damage. Probably would love to come in from behind the turret and pick someone off, but it is just such a dangerous place for Syndra to be.
There's so much counter engage, though. Like, diving Curse would be hard. Morgana ulti, absolute zero. Lulu ults whoever gets big. You CC someone before they can flash out. Like, that's a pretty big risk. Thankfully, Complexity do have a fair bit of range here. They're trying to poke this turret down slowly but surely. Robert gets to lifesteal off of the double golems a little bit.
It's interesting that they're having so much difficulty pushing this outer turret. This is generally one of the most dangerous or impossible turrets to defend against because teams will always provide a flank threat. So that would be Westrice and Kez kind of behind the turret while the rest of Complexity assaults from the front. But I think they're so afraid of Curse just rushing down the lane if Westrice and Kez try a flank attack that they're unable to siege this turret. I mean, the fact that Curse can hold this outer tier turret while Complexity had the Baron buff on quite a few people means Complexity needs to pull some tricks to actually get meaningful damage done to the structures of Curse.
Looks like they're just not quite able to. In fact, a big wave pushed the other side around to the top side, but it's Complexity who wants to stay it down here because Dragon's coming up. Push that gold lead a bit farther to maybe 7k. Westrex actually does go top, but he has TP.
I wonder if Curse could find a quick initiation and Westrice would be slow to the party. You can see Complexity is very hesitant about this dragon. They are respecting the teamfight potential of Void Boy's Orianna. That shockwave really turned that fight in the jungle before the Baron debacle happened. What a nice stun.
Yeah. Can't see the pink ward, though. But ward's still going back and forth. Both of them go down. Trades pretty equal. The game is incredibly close here, but the 6,000 gold lead in the start there. Flame Trap has come down, and down it goes right away. Last hit goes over to Robert X. Lee, but more gold for Complexity, 4 of 4 dragons, every Baron as well, of course. You guys are playing the objectives very well. Curse have not found their way in.
I hope probably went to the bathroom before this game, because I think it's going to be a long one. Just based on how unsuccessful that push in the bottom lane was.
Yeah.
And the pattern of Complexity games in the past. They are most likely going to try to build up a huge insurmountable lead before going in, and Curse is going to be a little bit gun-shy about making big moves based on that Baron play that happened. Meanwhile, I think Complexity would hold a slight edge late game, mainly because Maokai will be so unkillable, and Jinx will be able to really clean up those late game teamfights.
Yeah, one of the big things about Kog'Maw, actually, is even though he's the sort of anti-tank champion, right, a lot of percent health damage, percent shreds and whatnot, his W's only on half the time. So if you don't die after the first 8 seconds, he's now a 500 range AD carry against a Syndra, which is not a good thing to be at all. So they can theoretically tank out Cop's W and then be like, all right, bring it, you can't fight us. And Maokai's good at making that happen.
It really depends how much farm Westrise can get during the stall phase as well. You can see how Westrise is trying to be a split pusher right now. So they're trying to give Maokai the empty lane farm. They really know that in order to close this game out, he not only has to tank the team of Curse, but also the turrets, which is one of the reasons I think he's gone with that Randwin's right, or going with the Warden's Mill right now.
Yeah. Could be towards Frozen Heart. We'll see which way it is. Froggen, the man who played mid Malphite yesterday.
In a 100-kill game.
Yeah.
That was very sad. I'm playing against Yutwin in one of my fantasy leagues, and he has Froggen, Tabs, and Kerb on his team. That hurt. I still might win.
Yeah?
We'll see.
There's a chance. I thankfully grabbed Creatine a couple weeks ago. That was a good choice. All right, let's see. So Westrise actually have seen him win most of these fights against Kwas. In general, it feels like he has good headway here. Just does so much initial damage to him.
I don't think it's possible for them to kill each other, though, at this point in the game. They can hurt each other and set up kills for others, which is the main thing they're going to be watching out for, which is why Kwas is falling back right now.
But look at this by Complexity. They managed
nice move
to get their way around the jungle and in on this top, this bottom tier 2. That one does go down, making it 5-3 in turrets now. And Baron's back up, but Complexity don't have wards on it yet. Not enough, I would say.
I would be really impressed if Complexity can close this game within the next 10 minutes. Basically because it would mean they have really grown as a team, right? Especially if they want to become a playoff contender. Obviously winning this game is a big step towards that, which would mean they kind of want to take it slow. But if they could somehow do more moves like that, chip down the turrets, force another Baron, get a fight, and just roll that through to a victory, that would be like a top-tier team type move.
Yeah. And it's interesting to see you talk about, you know, Complexity growing as a team, playing well. Kez definitely is a sort of risk-averse style shot caller. He's actually a really big departure from Broken Shard. He just wants to fight all the time. But it does give them some very, very slow games when they're ahead. They are very...
They don't have vision at Baron. They let it drop because they were pulling off too many moves down bottom.
Ward comes down, half HP in this one. The whole team is here,
really
though,
making a move right here.
But the ball's in a really good spot. It was right in the brush, too, which is great by Voy.
Yeah. They fall back at the appropriate moment.
Bottom wave pushing away from Curse's base. Top wave roughly treading water. Complexity now own the vision game here. I believe there's one ward still in Baron for Curse, though. Only one pink in the inventory of Complexity.
And probably will have to use that one wisely. They have to make sure that they don't give up positioning.
Great ball by Voy.
Who can land the spells first? The interesting thing here is if Curse lands something, Bubba Dub and Westrise are such a powerful front line that they may be able to stop the initiation. But how do they actually get on Cop?
W's down right now for a few seconds, but they don't use that to go in. Voy gets slowed.
Ooh, Voy's really low on mana. That's really bad for Curse as a whole. He would not be able to stick around in the team fight for very long, unless he stops casting spells for about 30 seconds to let that Athene's regen his mana up a bit.
Or maybe they'd one-shot someone to get the mana back from that, but it seems to not be the case here. Curse definitely giving Complexity room to breathe. If these guys get in through the choke point, Curse backs up. They're not able to say, you know what, stand on this ball.
Forget about it, please.
Yeah. But Voy has been putting, anytime they retreat, he's putting it right in the choke point.
This Baron goes down really fast, too.
And they're
Curse
trying.
Is basically forced into a situation where they either check or push mid, but the scrying orb from Cop, great timing.
Oh, there's a Dark Binding. Can they get the engage here? Curse gonna back off, stun. Forces the flash away from Xspecial.
Yikes.
There's a summoner spell down, and Complexity fairly healthy here.
And they know that there's only so many scrying orbs you can use on the Baron Pit. It's on cooldown now. This one is harder for Curse to push in on. They're getting pretty chunked down.
There's that. Will Dominant go in on the Nuno, and he goes down. Flash from probably, but he trades his life for it. Bubba trying to keep the team alive. Westray still there. They stay on the Baron, and it is picked up there by Kez. One for one so far. The fight continues. Westray's on the front line. It's not going to go down. There's Cup. Goes in with a shockwave. Wants Robert. He does get the kill. Now Quas is around, but Complexity still have three members alive. Kez goes gigantic. And Quas forced to run away.
What a fight, though. That was really just an all-in from both teams. Quas probably going to get away as well, but four kills for Complexity plus the Baron. Good lord, this game.
Curse thought that was their way back in. I feel like it's hard to give a team two Barons, let them keep scaling up.
Let's see exactly what happens right here. So Bubbadub tries his own, probably gets hit by a binding, which means he doesn't even ult at this point, which means Curse thinks they have a good chance at going in for this fight. But again, the Baron goes at the wrong time, and Cobb gets Lulu ulted really early. So really before they put a huge amount of damage onto him, and he flashes in, hoping he'd be able to clear this one up, but I believe he ate a cocoon from Kez there, stopped DPS, and the rest of Complexity could shut him down. Yet still, because Complexity lost two people here and were so low, they still need to be able to crack that inhibitor wall.
And with the Baron buff on roughly, what, three people? Maybe it's enough for them to keep regenning, but the two ranged champions don't have it. Kez gonna walk into a black shield and take a slow from Nunu. Drag it back up. Looks like the team's really not ready for this, though. Robert's on the wrong side of the map. The Curse don't quite know that. They don't have vision around till just now. Complexity sit 11.2 thousand ahead. They have been really focused on getting the neutral objectives in, but they've got to be careful because mid's already being pushed and they're late to the party.
Yeah, Cop is still doing a bunch of damage as well, going attack speed focus build, which synergizes well with the pick's damage. But
oh,
here
wow.
comes a Maokai. They want to fight. Can he get in range?
Whimsy and the slow. Voidu says no.
All right. So teleport down. That's not too impactful at this stage of the game, because Westroy doesn't really need it to force pressure anymore.
Oh, wow.
Everyone's so far back.
Curse on the wrong side, though. This turret can get backdoored, and there's going to be a while till Curse shows.
Curse is willing to come in from the side, which seems a little suicidal. Curse.
Some decent damage.
Man, this is tough.
They're trying.
They're
going to
lose their turret.
Three man stun in from Prowly, and this turret is dying rapidly there.
Curse has to go the other way,
Robert. They finally go around the other way, realizing the first way didn't work. The side door of their own base, Xspecial. Oof, Binding gets a minion though.
Curse gets out-rotated right there for their inhibitor turret, something they could have easily defended if they were in position. But instead, Complexity makes a great move to move around the Curse team and cut them off from their own inhibitor. Yeah, this is a relentless amount of pressure as well. Curse is just quite low.
Cop gets the black shield, gets the Lulu shield as well. It's not going to be enough to stop the inhibitor from going down, though. The shockwave not going to land in time. Nearly caught the tail ends there, but Complexity get out safe.
I think Complexity was planning on going back to base. They might not anymore, knowing the shockwave is down.
Big wave bottom.
It would be a great time to push bottom, but instead they take Zidragon.
Risk-averse style.
Super risk-averse, man. That was a golden opportunity to push more. Baron region would have taken them all back up, and there's no shockwave threat.
Well, 30 seconds on the Baron buff means once they recall and buy, it's going to be gone. And they're going to be on equal footing aside from the 13,000 gold lead, but that means a full infinity edge up for the AD carry. It means actually very little across the mid laners right now. But Westrice is a gigantic tank right there. He's got the Frozen Heart on as well, so he's already got two auras plus his ultimate.
True.
Westrice, second support.
Yeah, he's an aura bot that is really hard to die.
Yeah.
You'd think if a guy has a bunch of auras, maybe we just take him out first. Yeah, it's tricky against a Maokai right now.
Still has a bit of threat himself. You saw him do a fair bit of damage when he tried to stop the Baron earlier in this game, and that worked out well for Complexity. 0-1-6, not a remarkable score, but to be honest, still a very well-played game by the man. Looks like top now, the area of attention. Zonya's Hourglass completed for Prolly. So there you're seeing kind of one full item per roll down the line here for Complexity.
That's pretty damn substantial too. If we're talking about these team fights, Boy Boy yet to land a great Shockwave as well. That's pretty much what they would need. They would need a fantastic Shockwave and probably a fair bit of turret help as well. I mean, we even saw a fight where Curse was able to kill Prolly before he could use a Cinder ultimate, and Complexity still won the fight. There is just a huge amount of things that need to go exactly right for Curse to win a team fight.
And it might just start with the ball you see on your screen right here. Can Complexity play around it? Orianna, definitely one of the better defenders. You see him put it out and then walk plenty far back to not be in range of any engage himself. Quas is the guy on defense duty. They say Orianna cogs enough to defend top lane.
I mean, that's the crappy thing about having Kog'Maw as your only main threat right here. They would love to have someone with better wave clear defend that super minion wave off, but Lulu's the best they got at him. He's full-time defending, which means they have to 4v5.
And it's still down to half HP.
Jeez. The critical thing about defending those super minion waves is to never let two super minions get together.
Yeah.
They have an aura that gives a whole bunch of stats, and it double buffs each other, so it works both ways. They become much stronger when they're two super minions together.
Yeah, the MR goes from like negative 30 to 10, which is a substantial damage loss when you're someone like Lulu or Kog'Maw. Magic damage kind of relevant in those cases. And the damage gets buffed a bunch as well. They go in a little bit there. Bubba Dub loses a quarter of his health. But this is actually Robotnik's lead down to half, though. He's got to be pretty careful. Ulti lands as well.
Two shots from Kog'Maw.
He needs to lifesteal off his Bloodthirster.
No, they're getting a little bit aggressive here. Black Boy Shield is off, though.
I'm going to get sent away, though. There's
can't
the
use
rest
any more alts
of the Banshees.
Running Complexity off their base there.
There's a big wave in mid, though. They've got to react to, like, right
they
now.
They got
to
go back.
Oh, my God.
There's a chance Complexity to cut them off again. They want to fight
they
right now.
They get the new Flash ults from especially pop the Zonias. This is a fight. Curse must win, and Dominate's going to go down. Bubba claims the kill. Prolly and Robert very low. Shockwave catches two. Can they keep chasing? Cop goes in. He finds
that's
Robert. Can he keep going? Bubba goes down. West Race and Kez, the only ones alive. Cop still dealing damage. The inhibitor responds in mid. Curse are safe here, and they are still chasing. Black Shield on for Especial. Puddle goes down. West Race got no mana. One, two more shots from Cop. That will be the kill picked up. That is a 4-for-2 for Curse.
And Baron is up right now. Holy crap. We talked about all the things, Freak, that needed to go right for Curse to win a fight.
Yeah.
And most of those things were true. Robert X Lee and Prolly were too low to get engaged in a fight. Again, Prolly could not get his ult, but that binding from X Special, absolutely critical. But then watch Robert. Over the wall, Cough is hitting him a few times. Neither of those guys are doing damage, so it's just the tank line. And who cares about tanks if you can go past them? Shockwave kills one, Cough flashes for another, puts on that aggressive mindset that he needs to have when he is the only threat in a team. And at that point, Maokai and Elise are not much without the backup of their damage dealers. They get ran down. And the inhibitor timing for respawning was absolutely exquisite. Curse keeps themselves alive in this game, but because of the amount of minions in their base, the Baron could not be secured.
And so actually Ward Control might just stay on Complexity's side as Dragon comes up fairly soon. And we talked about the item leads that were here for Complexity because of the gold lead. Robert X Lee, I think, got literally one or two basic attacks off on champions that fight.
Yeah, and probably didn't get to use his ultimate.
Yeah, and probably is really just not been able to do much damage himself either, despite having his Zonias actually as well. Unless he popped it, I don't think so.
He did pop it, but that's after he was already low, and then afterwards he got killed by Orianna. That is one of the things you opt into when you pick Cinder, though. It is much more of a lane bully champion, and she has immense vulnerabilities in team fights if teams are good about getting on top and pushing her out of team fights. And that is really a struggle Prolly has had to deal with in this game.
He's
These guys are rushing.
That is not a good
Brawly
time design.
Brawly does not press the right buttons there. He's got a good three-man shockwave. Brawly force out of the fight, gets a shield. Keslo as well. Bubbit up knocked into the air. Wester's trying to run away with the ulti on. They're still trying to run, though. This is a fight that Complexity do not think they can win. Binding's going to miss. Boy gets stunned and slowed. They will back off, and now Curse.
They want this, but Complexity still has five people alive. This... we've seen this before. What's going to happen this time? Complexity's a little bit lower.
Five low health players.
What
a three-man stun in from Brawly. Are they going to stay on Baron? Looks like yes. Dominate wants it. Ulti's going to catch it special. And now Curse don't want it. But Complexity do? Are you serious?
Of course they do. Look at how low Boy is right now. They think they can zone off.
Oh! Dominate cannot spite it in time. Flashes it and dies for it. Boy one hit from dead. 5v3 on the map with Baron.
Curse had to run away right there. They were not content just keeping the game equal despite being able to win fights at their base, and instead they try and force a Baron with nobody dead on the other side. Not a good idea. Now they have substantial death timers, an exposed inhibitor, and maybe more to lose.
15 seconds on Xspecial, 25 on I Will Dominate. Will they backdoor a turret? Will Curse even try to defend this? Shockwave is back up. Wester is tanky, though.
Ultimate is back for Brawly as well. If he lands a stun, there's not enough. I don't think there's enough shielding
alive.
Oh,
the black shield is down, and the cocoon lands, slowed by Braum as well. And they're going to do the damage on... wow! Down goes Boy did not have a Zhonya's. That is the mid laner gone for a minute.
Or any substantial magic resistance. This is just... maybe another move that could win Complexity a game. You never know, though, in these Complexity versus Curse games.
Risk aversion.
Is dead.
They go still. Bot lane here.
And they still have Baron on five people. Westrice going back to base. He's going to teleport back.
Red buff steal.
May as well renew it. They're just waiting for the Maokai and the creep wave anyway. They want to get this third inhibitor. They have 30 seconds. If they get the third inhibitor here, they may as well wrap up the game.
There's
how
a TP.
Are they gonna defend? It's 4v5.
Invincible minion, 4v5 for 20 seconds. Bubba up in the front line, takes some damage from Kopp. This turret's going to be going down. Get excited, they slow down Kopp. Black shield's on, but he walks away just in time. Binding hits Kez, but there's no follow-up there. 10 seconds on Boy. Three inhibitors dead. There's a big minion wave. Baron buff still on.
Freak, for all the times that Brawly was getting caught in bad positions in team fights, he made up for all of them with those two big plays he just made. The stun over the wall while Curse was doing Baron to do a substantial amount of damage and push Curse completely off, followed by the kill onto Boy, which basically secured them the second and third inhibitor and will make clearing minions an absolute chore for Curse in the next few minutes.
And they're going to do that as much as they can.
And we still got over 15 minutes before we're at the average game time of this matchup.
We are their second fastest right now. Yep. 38-43. Wait, am I on the wrong sheet?
Yeah. And if we follow the trends, the games are only getting longer. The first game was 43 minutes.
Yep.
The second was 57. And the third was 1 hour and 20 minutes. Which means we should be in for about 55 more minutes of gameplay. But I'm not really sure how that's going to happen with the current state of things.
Hashtag 90 minutes the dream, guys.
Wouldn't it be like 105 if we keep the trends? Or wait, no, 100.
Let's see. Well, it went plus 14 and then plus 23. So it's accelerating. The increase in time is going up. So it's like plus 30 minutes. About an hour and 50 would be the pattern there.
Yeah, there's a real chance, though, the Complexity ends on this push. Curse is incredibly hard-pressed to keep the minions at bay. There's a huge risk that a Stray will get caught out by Syndra and push things off. Even if Curse starts launching an offensive, the super minions are together, so they are so incredibly powerful. And basically, Curse needs to devote a third to half of their spell and mana pools just into clearing minions, and two-thirds of Curse's team is not enough to fight off five Baron members of Complexity.
Big stun on Xspecial. Ulti comes by. Nice Zhonya's, but low health bars on Curse. Here comes the push. Knockup comes through. Support is dead, and here come the super minions as well. Basically a 6-on-4. The dive comes in. I Will Dominate falls over, and this is going to surely be the game. Complexity, in about 46 minutes, gonna own the tiebreaker against Curse and be one win away from playoffs. One game behind Curse.
This makes things so fascinating for the remainder of Super Week. That was the game Curse targeted for a win. Complexity knew how important this was as well. The fact that they pulled that off means it's go time.
So all they need now is a record that, for the rest of the three games, is one win better than Curse, and they're going top six.
Yeah.
They said at the start of the split, Complexity, we know we're underdogs. We know teams are going to overlook us. But all we want to do this split is get better.
Well, they've definitely done that. They are substantially better from the team that entered the North American LCS some months ago. That game in particular, breaking out the new top lane pick from Westrice with Maokai, but really, a lot of really crazy decisions around the Baron pit and Complexity coming out on top of those again and again, holding a lead ever so slightly and actually finishing the game in 46 minutes, which for Complexity is fast.
Yeah, it is.
So this is a very real opportunity that we could be seeing Complexity making a run at the playoffs this Super Week.
Well, it's going to be four games for each team throughout the week. Of course, Curse, Complexity have played one of them so far. We've got, what, 19 left? Is it? I like forget how many games right. are played in Super Week. 16. We've got 15 games left this week.
We play 16 games in a Super Week. Every team plays four times. So Complexity, they have just defeated Curse. The games they still have to play this Super Week, not in order, but they have to play Cloud9, EG, and CLG.
Yeah.
CLG is playing with four subs this week.
Mm-hmm.
EG is a team they're actually 1-2 against, so that's going to be a tough one.
Yep.
Cloud9's actually the team they have the best record against. They're 2-1 against Cloud9 already.
You know, they had a 2-1 record against Curse, beat them. 2-1 record against Dignitas, beat them. They've turned 2-1s into 3-1 so far. Right. Like, statistically,
right.
that's a win.
But at the same time, they're still one game back. So if Curse takes care of business, it won't matter what Complexity does.
Sure.
Curse, as well, has to play TSM, who they are yet to defeat this Super Week. LMQ, who they're actually 2-1 against.
Mm-hmm.
And then also Dignitas, who we have to see how they turn up this week because they have been on a bit of a slide. I'm excited.
I am too.
Those are some really big games that we have coming up.
It's a really big run for the playoffs. Of course, it could still go either way. And to be fair, Curse are still in control of their own destiny. I mean, we're hyping up the Complexity road up there because it's really exciting and interesting. They've done well so far. But as long as Curse are still a game ahead. If they stay a game ahead, they hold that playoff spot. That is their goal coming in this week, is just hold on to that top six. It's a team that has beaten guys in the top three. We know they can reach these incredibly high heights.
Yep.
And it's just which Curse shows up each game.
And how does Curse handle the pressure?
That's true.
Is the biggest question, because they haven't handled it well as of yet. Every time they have that big week, they pretty much always follow it up with a poor one. And when the games really, really matter is when they have to turn it up. They matter more than ever now because they just lost their game that pretty much would have secured it.
Yeah, and you saw like little parts of it during the game, like these really tense Baron calls, and every one of them happened to backfire for these guys. Now, everyone, remember to share your favorite moments from today's action by tweeting at LOL Esports and using the hashtag LCSBigPlays. Now, to get the pros' perspective on that match, let's send it over to the guys at the analyst desk.
Thanks, Freak. We want to welcome Complexity's Prolly to the desk. After a great game against Curse to start off your Super Week, you're now 3-1 against Curse. So talk to me a little bit about the importance of that match specifically.
I don't know. I have no clue what the standings look like. So the importance of each match is kind of like everyone's the same. It's like we just need to win.
Do you want me to tell you?
I don't think I want to know.
Okay. We'll keep it a secret. You're pretty close.
We're first,
pretty
right?
close.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. That's what I thought.
Okay. Well, speaking of first, though, you know, looking at Worlds, what's your plan for Samsung Blue?
I think the best way to win that game is just not have a plan. So I'm sticking to that. And I think it'll work out well.
It is working out pretty well for you guys so far. But I got to ask you, we had an interview with Koobs before. What type of motivational style does he use? Are you a bowl of whipped cream or you a bowl of poop kind of guy?
I think I'm more of a whipped cream. I think I need a lot of compliments or else I'll just be really bad. Because if he sits there and he's like, so you missed that CS and that CS, I'll be like, no, I didn't. No, I didn't. And he's like, okay, you did well on CS. I'm like, okay, thanks. And then I'll go improve on my own kind of thing.
All right, well, you actually had a fabulous game, this game. And we're going to pull up a replay real quick of pretty early. Well, we're going to point one little thing out later. Don't you worry.
Don't point it out.
But first, we're going to pull up the first replay. It's about 9:45 into the game. You make a great roam bot. So just talk to me about how this opportunity came about. You pick up the double kill.
Okay. At first, I start just running around trying to see where their wards are around mid. And I noticed that they didn't have any on the road to bot lane. So I start looking at bot, and I notice my team's fighting. So I was like, oh, man, this is perfect. So I start walking down, and I just sit there going, like, guys, don't die. Just survive right now. And I end up not even using my ult because they almost win the trade. And so I just come in and I assume they don't have flashes, because that's a bad thing to assume, but I just do. And then just pretty much pick up the fight because they got baited to fight my teammates.
And then he gets out and he pours one out for his homies on the back.
Yep.
It was really, really, just watching that interaction there was fantastic. And the roam down without the wards was really, really good coverage there. All game, you guys had complete ward control. Was that just because you had every objective, or was it just the other way around?
I mean, we had a lot of wards out because that's kind of what we think the meta is. So we focused a lot on that game, is just getting wards out.
Now, I talked to Koobs before the game. And I kind of want to touch some of the same points with you, which is we've got 1 week left, or we're in the final week of the split. So what's it been like being back in the LCS, specifically for you? And what's this journey been like compared to the last time?
This one feels a lot more, I guess, like personal. And I feel more connected to the team because I qualified with this team. The last time I was in the LCS, I was kind of picked up. So making the LCS and then starting a team from 0-0 makes every single game really personal to me, and I don't know. I feel like I just really want to win a lot more and kind of want to make my mark right now.
It definitely showed too, because your average game time against Curse is typically over an hour, and this game was 46 minutes long. What was the difference here?
We just made a mistake and ended it when we could have stalled for another 40 minutes, so we'll try to fix it next
game. How dare you?
Yeah, our bad.
All right, well, I want to jump into the game to another replay. Our second replay is 21 minutes into the game. You guys end up stealing the Baron after giving away a bit of a team fight in the red side jungle. How important was it that Kez got those home guard boots?
Oh, man, it was super important. Kez was on point with his smites this game. So right now, it's just they're all low, so Maokai is trying to bait their damage onto him, and he actually goes in at the perfect time, because Elise is able to get there. And we're calling out, kill Nunu, and then right when Nunu goes down, it's, oh, do Baron. And then while this is happening, we go, oh my god, we have no damage. No, Baron is not dying. So right now, we're just hopefully Kopp doesn't kill us, because we're throwing saplings and kind of scaring him. And we end up getting the Baron, and then right then we get our AD carry to come. And right now it's just salvage time. It's like, we already got Baron, just try to survive as much as possible. And we end up getting, a kill off of Lulu because she had no ult. So then, Jinx with her little cheating reset skill, we just run him down.
Hey, you guys gave yourself a really big buffer there to make some mistakes. And then speaking of mistakes, the next Baron, actually two Barons later, is Zhonya's in the pit.
Yeah.
I'm going to give you a bowl of poop on that one. What was going on?
Okay, so I suck, number one. And number two, I think I just bought Zhonya's. And I put my pinks on one normally. And so I put my pinks on two and my Zhonya's on one. So I go, oh man, I need to pink this pixel bush because it's going to distract them. So I go to press one and I Zhonya's, I go, oh, team help me. Team help, team help. And luckily, I think I survived, too.
The binding almost
you did.
Hit
the
you right
yeah,
after.
The binding went straight through the Zhonya's before you came out of it. And Aiden and I were actually talking during the game about how cool would it be if you could actually deactivate Zhonya's, because there's times when it actually is a disadvantage to be in it for the 1.5 seconds that you're in it. But luckily, that binding didn't hit. You guys managed to survive. But that was quite a scary moment. So in moments like that, when you have blown something very important, what's the communication like? Because you're facing a fight right there. That could be a team fight at any moment. So are you even bothering to tell people, I can't fight? Or is that I'll keep it to myself. Let's play it out.
Well, in that fight, we kind of had the advantage because we have, a lot of damage and stuff. So if it was swapped, say I was playing Ori and they had Syndra, and then I Zhonya's like that as Ori, they would have just collapsed on me. But I was playing Syndra, so if a squishy target came in, I would still be able to get my ult off. So they were still kind of scared of me when I came out of Zhonya's. And then my team was backing me up, which was really good. Because I think, right when I got Zhonya's, I was just yelling, team, team help. So my team backed me up, and then I think that kind of scared them a bit to all in me. So I was able to get out of a terrible situation to put myself in.
All right, and you guys actually play CLG tomorrow. And you guys have always kind of been regarded as the ragtag team. And we heard Koobs and a bunch of other people on your team talk about how you guys aren't typically respected, and now you are demanding that respect because you're taking off top teams. Do you think CLG needs to be respected this week? Or do you think people are going to underestimate them?
Yeah. I mean, honestly, we're going to prepare for CLG as hard as we can because, that's the best way to lose a game is sit there and go, this team can't beat us, and then you go into the game and they get a whole bunch of kills and snowball the game. So we're going to go into it like it's real CLG. Obviously, we'll change a lot of picks and bans and stuff like that, but we're going to try really hard just like we did today.
Is it tough to prepare against a team that has never played together before? Because you don't have really any information to pull from other than solo queue.
Yeah, I think that's our only information. Is I guess they played this guy a lot in solo queue. I guess we'll ban it. So our bans are probably going to be what's most played by Hotshot, what's most played by, you know, the top laner. Because honestly, it's going to be hard to kind of pick and ban against them right now.
All right. And you guys actually have Cloud9 later today, and you're 2-1 against them in that matchup. And when you play two games a day, what's that stress like? You guys did keep this game time shorter, so you're a little less fatigued, I assume. Do you feel more warmed up? What's it like coming into that?
It should be pretty good for this game because we have a two-game break right now. So we're going to be able to go, you know, celebrate our win a little bit and then kind of chill out and then kind of recoup and, you know, focus on C9 right now because we spent all this time focusing on Curse. And now we have, what, a two-hour break to focus on C9. So we're going to spend the next 2 hours, you know, relaxing and then focusing for our next game.
All right, now, I know you mentioned you don't really keep track of the standings, but you are one game back of Curse.
Oh, don't tell him.
I mean, you're in first.
I thought we were first.
Right. Ooh, the bubble's been burst. No, so you're one game back of Curse at the current moment, but that game puts you in great position because you now own the tiebreaker. So looking forward at C9, who you're 2-1 in, you're 2-1 against, you got CLG, who is playing with a team of subs, and then I forget the final game of the week, you're playing EG. So how do you feel, how confident are you that we're going to see Complexity sneak into that sixth spot and play in the playoffs?
I mean, I'm happy with the team. As long as I don't do what I did from 20 minutes to 40 minutes, I think we'll have a really good chance of fixing our standings and getting where we want to be.
All right, and final question here. If you guys do make it to playoffs, who are you hoping to face in the first round? Which would be your ideal team to take down? It's a tough one.
LMQ's first.
Right now they are.
Well,
there are still
us.
Our chances, yeah.
Then I think that's probably our best chance. Whoever's first place right now is who we need to face.
Naturally.
Yeah.
Yeah. Got to go for that first. You got to use the blue shell. You've got them. You might as well use them, right?
Blue shell can miss the other people. It will always hit the first place.
Absolutely. All right. Well, Prolly, thank you so very much for joining us at the desk, for having some fun with us and all of that. We are going to take a quick break while we set up the Rift for the next match. Don't go anywhere. The LCS continues after this.
It's a remix. We gotta go out there. Go play some League of Legends.
Second kill back then for Kopp, and now Robert's gotta be real careful. Flash to the wall, but Pop's gonna chase him down. He wants a triple. He gets it. Rush right to the front line. It's not gonna go down. There's Kopp. Goes in with a shockwave. Wants Robert. He does get the kill. Now Floss is around. Dominate's gonna go down. Bubba claims the kill. Prolly and Robert very low. Shockwave catches two. Can they keep chasing? Kopp goes in. He finds Robert.